Today I will be sharing with you my top 5 study tips. One thing I do want to say is that I won't be going over things like
you should go to lecture, pay attention during class, don't procrastinate, don't leave things until last minute,
things like that. I think those are just basic student responsibilities, and it's been said like a million times, so today's tips are very specific to things that I have done and have learned throughout the years. Tip number one is to create summary sheets, and I can't stress how important this is to me, and it's something that I've been doing since at least grade 11. Basically, what I do is, before each test, if there's going to be 5 chapters on the midterm, I'm going to make 5 summary sheets, 1 page per chapter. Basically, if you have to summarize an entire chapter onto just 1 page, it'll force you to think about the most important concepts, and that way you'll understand what exactly you're learning, and you're not just mindlessly memorizing different facts. And it doesn't matter whether your course is more memorization-based or math-based, I've used this technique for all my different courses. So I dug up some old notes, and I'll show you guys 3 examples. The first one is from my biology course. I had a lot of different viruses I had to memorize, and a lot of details and diagrams. And I use a few different colors, and I keep this consistent across all my subjects. Black marker is for the title. Red is for any list that I make, so I'll number everything in red. And then green is for any dates, years, or measurements. So here I have nanometers written in green. And then I'll use blue for just regular notes, and then pencil for examples and diagrams. And by doing this, if you ever need to find something, you can quickly locate it on your sheet of paper. What I find really helpful about these summary sheets is that sometimes on a final exam, you don't want to go back and look at like a million different lecture slides and reread the entire chapter or your notes. So if you have these summary sheets for things that were taught earlier in the semester, you can just quickly glance at it, because a lot of the times final exams don't even test you about the things earlier on in that much detail, and maybe you just need to understand the main concept. And by having these summary sheets, you can save yourself a lot of time at the end of the course. The second example I have is for one of my introductory physics courses that I took in university. I essentially just made myself a summary equation sheet, and I separated it by different sections. So here I have kinematics, and I just wrote a few equations down. Basically, at the end of the course, you just want to ask yourself what each equation is for and when it's used. The third example I have is something from our organic chemistry course. And if you ask any life science student what they think of organic chemistry, most people would be like, oh my god, it's like the most difficult course ever, it's like my worst nightmare. But it was actually one of my favorite courses, and I actually did really well in the course. And I think I owe it to the summary sheet that I made. So basically, this is not really a summary sheet, but more of a flow chart. And what I did was, at the end of the course, I summarized all the different reactions and mechanisms that were taught, and I made this massive flow chart. This flowchart isn't something that I would really look back at and try to learn the concepts again. Rather, I think this was helpful because the process of making it is what helped me gather all the different concepts that I've learned throughout the semester and to summarize it onto one page. Tip number 2 has to do with notebooks, and this is my to-do list. So I know a lot of people like to make to-do lists that just outline what they should do for the day, but I don't like doing that. I like to write out every single thing I have ongoing for each different subject. And I'll write all the subjects on the left side, and then each assignment, homework, or chapter I have to read on the right side. And by doing that, I know exactly how much stuff I have on hand that I have to do. And how I prioritize it is, I'll use a yellow highlighter for the things that I want to do today, orange for things that I want to do tomorrow, and then pink if necessary for the third day. And by doing that, I can have an idea of how much I can accomplish in 3 days. On the bottom left part of the page, I would usually write stuff that has to do with my extracurriculars. So I run a nonprofit, and there's a lot of things that I have to do, such as updating the website, which I have to do pretty often. And sometimes if you're so focused on school and deadlines, you will not remember these kind of small little things that you have to do, and it'll just slip through your mind. The most important part of my to-do list is to write out each time frame for each item in pencil. So I'll write out what time I need to wake up at. So if it's 6 o'clock, I'll write wake up 6 o'clock, and then breakfast, and then I'll put chapter 1 if I need to spend like 60 minutes on it, then I'll write 7 to 8 a.m. and then I'll write all the little times for that. And if I need to go to the gym that day, I'll allocate an hour to an hour and a half for it. And then I'll write in dinner time, and then I'll even include shower time and when I'm going to sleep. And I usually like to do this scheduling the night before, because if I know I have so much stuff to do the next day and I already scheduled all the different time slots for it, I will feel obligated to wake up on time instead of clicking the snooze button for like 2 hours. And it's totally okay if you don't follow your timeline exactly. That's exactly why I write everything in and pencil, because if I do need to make adjustments, I can easily just erase it. Tip number three is really important to me because my professor has actually complimented me on this method. Basically, if I have any questions while I'm doing readings or I'm doing homework, I'll write it down on a piece of paper and pen. I'll save up the questions from a few days before I go to the professor. When you're done asking, you can use pencil and write the answer down in your own words. And by kind of rephrasing what the professor just said, it kind of reinforces the idea in your head and it helps you memorize, you know, how he explained it. At the end of the semester when you're studying for the exam, or even just a day or two later when you're revisiting the material, if you don't understand again and you're like, oh my gosh, how did the professor explain it? You might not remember, then now you have to go back to the office and ask again. It's not only a waste of your time, it's also a waste of the professor's time, and there's a million other students waiting to ask questions. Tip number four, basically in grade 9 and 10, my math grades were not the best, and it was actually one of my weakest subjects, and I was really frustrated because I just felt really dumb. I was like, why is everyone else getting this, and I'm just having such a hard time wrapping my head around the concept. My mom suggested me to go see a tutor, and at that time I had this whole impression that like if I see a tutor that means that I'm not as smart as other people, but it was honestly the best decision because seeing a tutor doesn't mean that you're dumb. In fact, it's the complete opposite. It means that you're willing to actually, you know, utilize the resources you have around you to get the grade that you want. So I just signed up for one tutoring lesson. I just went on Kijiji and found some random retired math teacher, and we met up at the public library, and he explained it in a way that I was never like exposed to, and it helped me understand it just like that. And one tutoring lesson was honestly all that I needed. And from grade 10 to grade 11, my math grades went from low 80s to high 90s right away, and I was just having such a great time in math class. I ended up graduating high school with the math department award, and I got one of the highest marks in the grade. And honestly, that kind of taught me that you shouldn't be ashamed of going to tutoring. What you need to understand the material might be different from your classmate. Tip number five, this has to do with an agenda. So I use a monthly format agenda, and there's a lot of colors here as you can see. Basically, what I suggest you guys to do is to mark down all the most important school dates at the beginning of your school year. So in September, just look at your school's website and mark down reading week, Christmas break, when the semester starts and ends. It takes 10 minutes in the beginning of the school year, but it'll save you a lot of time in the long run. I've met so many people who accidentally showed up on campus in lecture hall, and they texted me and they're like, oh, why is there no one here? And I'm like, it's a public holiday, or it's reading week, what are you doing? And they just wasted like an hour commuting to school just to find out that class is canceled. And another thing that I like to do is also color coding, of course. Anything that's marked in yellow are things related to school. So if I have an assignment or a midterm, I'll mark it in yellow. Then pink is for extracurricular activities, and then orange is for appointments. Whether they're doctor's appointments or appointments with professors, I will mark them down in orange. And then any random things that I need to do, for example, if it's my friend's birthday coming up and I need to get them a gift, I'll write it in pencil on the day. So those are my five tips. I hope you guys found it helpful. And if you do give it a try and notice, you know, any improvement in your grades, do let me know. And I would be happy to film more study-related videos in the future. I'll talk to you guys next time. Bye!